Hello, 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 everyone. Happy Monday. We have a special episode today that we are hosting today, July 1st on a Monday. I'm very excited to bring this episode to you because we have the unique opportunity to talk today to Laura Davidson from Tag Digital, and she is going to tell you a lot more about herself. But one of the reasons I'm very excited to talk to her today is that she kind of represents two different sides that at least I am always obsessed with. So there's the independent side. She started her own company, and also, of course, the technology side, the services, the events industry. And as you guys know, I'm a total tech geek, so I love to talk about technology. I'm hoping in today's conversation, we can learn not only more about Laura's career and how she started her company, but I do hope we can get into a little geeky talk as well and talk about how the technology she's developed is helping the events industry. So hopefully you'll learn not only from her career, but from her technology as well. So Laura, thank you so much for joining us today on the Event Hustler Show.
Thanks. Thanks for having me. It's nice to be here.
And I know you're calling in from Scotland. Is that correct?
I am, yes.
What time is it there?
It's 3:30 in the afternoon.
Okay. You're winding down. I'm on vacation tomorrow, so you're closer.
It's a July week.
Yes, exactly. But why don't you just start by telling everyone a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Hi. So, yeah, I'm Laura Davidson. I'm one of the founders at Tag Digital. So I started Tag Digital 8 years ago with my then boyfriend, now husband. And we started out kind of doing, you know, all types of digital services and clients. And then we started to specialize in events. And then we started to specialize in PPC. And kind of once we carved out that niche is when the company really started to grow. Has become pretty global in our reach.
That's awesome. Now, you said you started the company with your boyfriend turned husband, which is always a positive story. Sometimes it doesn't work out so well.
I know. I think people pause before I say, we're not together, but no, he's my husband. We have a 2-year-old and we work together every day. So it's good. It's a really, you share a common goal, which I think is great. And we have quite separate roles in the company as it's grown now.
Congratulations. That's in and of itself.
Yeah, I bet.
How did you get into the events industry in the first place? I know you said you started with your technology on a broader scale. So did you have experience with the events industry, or was it, did that look like?
Yeah, so I had worked, initially my background was in English and law, and then after university I actually came to New York and I worked there for a while, and then I worked back in London and back in Scotland, and I worked for a video startup, and part of our remit was to go film events and do interviews and all of those things, and that was really a good entry, I think, into the world of events. I loved that it was really fast-paced and there was loads happening. And I think one of the things that we love as a company is there's an end date. You know, you're all working towards this thing, but then it's over and you get a second to, you know, before you start planning the next one. So had a kind of little bit of an intro to the events world. And then that was good when we were, you know, we started the company and we thought, okay, who could our target client be? And we were thinking, you know, it could be anybody. And we were told to specialize maybe 6 or 7 years ago, and we thought no, anyone could be our client. And then eventually we knew some people at UBM, and UBM was one of our first event clients, now Informa, and that kind of got us in the door. And I think then once we were in there, we thought, this is, you know, huge. There's just so much that could be done here. So we started to get referred from one organizer to another organizer. People move around a lot in events, so then they said, oh, we know somebody. So it was quite an organic thing, I would say, to start with, how we kind of specialized once we were in with the events organizers. And then maybe 4 or 5 years ago, we made a conscious decision, like, this is the market, we're not going to work outside that market. So we turned down, like, you know, great clients out with that market. And that's, I think, when the company grew. And that was something I couldn't see, you know, 6, 7 years ago, that, well, how do we grow if we restrict our market? But it's been completely the opposite. Once we were focused and specialized, we've just become really, really good at doing one thing. And I think that's definitely the key, and something that I've learned when I was younger. I didn't get that at all.
It seems very like counterintuitive, right? Because I think, you know, if we can service all these clients, we have more opportunities if we stay more broad. And I had mentioned to you before we went on air, I feel like this is something we talk about on every episode, just that idea of defining your niche and how that opens so many revenue opportunities.
Yeah.
How does that work though? Because I mean, I know from my own experience, but you would think if you end up having to turn down clients who no longer fit into your niche, that you're somehow not going to be more successful, but you've been more successful in the last 4 or 5 years.
Yeah. Way more companies growing like, I don't know, over 1,000%, I'd say in those 4 years. So that has definitely been, I think having the confidence to say no took a while. But then once we did, it meant that people knew that we were more focused. And then what it allowed us to do was focus on, okay, what are the events for the event industry? What countries could we go to? So we were exporting to, now export to about 42 countries, but it was like 30 countries within a couple of years because we were so niche and we understood the events market. So you, I think you grow much faster in your niche than you ever would do in a broad sense. So yeah, we've grown, we've punched well above our weight from the early days with the clients that we got because we just spoke their language and we cut out all of the other stuff. So yeah, I think being focused, being international initially, I think just off the bat, you just have to think globally. Whereas I think if you do more broad, you tend to stay more local. I think most agencies, why would you use another agency in another country? You just use someone local. Whereas for us, it was important to be international straight away. And yeah, you just cut out a lot of the unknown things with other sectors because all of our clients want the same thing. You know, they want more data, they want new data, they want happy attendees, happy exhibitors, you know, engaged attendees at the show. So you're just refining that one thing all of the time, which maybe oversimplifies it, but I think it just keeps your attention in the one place, which has been really good for us.
Well, as we talk more about your company, I'm sure the audience will see there's a lot of overlap between what you're talking about and what you did with your company in terms of identifying your target audience, knowing that, and being able to target that, and what you're doing on the technology side. But I have to say, we're 8 minutes into this interview, and you just said the dreaded D word, data.
Oh, like, what did I say?
You looked very nervous when I started. event planners, I think, know that data is really important. They're very nervous about it, partially because it's something that maybe as a traditional event planner, we don't know a lot about. But also then there's GDPR and there's these lots of acronyms that we were a little bit confused about, to be honest. I'm as much included in that as every other event planner. So we haven't gotten much into what Tag Digital actually is. So can you tell us a little bit about what that is and then I'm sure I know from your company, you'll get into some of the acronyms that you guys with as well.
There's lots of acronyms. So Tag Digital, we do PPC for events, and PPC stands for pay per click. So pay per click advertising or paid advertising is just any ads that you click on, you pay for every single click. So I think there's a common misconception that that's just search keywords. So, you know, when you search for Google and you might look for security event New York, a bunch of ads will pop up there. So we are the strings behind that controlling those ads. And one of the misconceptions is that PPC is just search, but actually PPC covers search, social, display, and video. So what that means is if you... you know when you're on Facebook and you've maybe been looking for an event and then all of a sudden another event pops up that's really similar but not exactly the event you're looking at. So we do all that kind of thing as well. So kind of like you're saying, who's your target audience? And we would say, okay, we're looking for security professionals in the New York area. We're going to target them on search. We're going to show them a video on YouTube. We're going to target them on Facebook. And the whole idea behind all of that is we're building new data. So we're building new emails, new pre-registrations. We're engaging a new audience because everybody has, you know, churn events and you want to make sure that you're, you know, constantly feeding the funnel, that you're growing your more challenging sectors of the show, you're growing your internationals. So everything we're doing is designed around a conversion. So we might talk a bit today about that. And a conversion is ultimately you're trying to answer how much does it cost us to get one person to register for our security event in New York? How much does it cost us to get one exhibitor lead for a security event in New York? And that's called CPA, so cost per acquisition. And it means that you can know with certainty, okay, cost me $6 to get someone to New York, to my security event in New York, great stuff. I know how much budget I need, you know, to get 10,000 people to my event or 500 people to my event. So that's the great thing with PPC is, you know, exactly how much a click will cost you and how much it takes, how many clicks you need to get one result, basically.
Okay. So how did you guys learn this in the first place so that you can help other event organizers?
Yeah, good question. Lots of trial and error, I think. And there is a lot of testing in PPC because you need to make sure that you like your keywords are B2B focused and you're not getting mixed up with people who are looking for, you know, a home security system, for example. So lots of testing. We've built a lot of process around how do we get campaigns started. And I think that's something we took a lot of time over, which was painful, but really worth it in the long term. We test so many campaigns, you know, different images, different creative. Do people like when you say global or international? Do they like pictures of people or do they like pictures of things? So we've kind of built up this bank of knowledge, and we built a data benchmarking tool as well, which we analyzed 100,000 campaigns over a period of time. So we knew a lot of stuff anecdotally, I would say, up until maybe 18 months ago, and we could tell you all of this stuff, but as we scale and as we grow, we need to be able to look at that data in a more more of a bigger scale. So we built this tool, our data benchmarking tool. We looked at 100,000 campaigns in all different regions, all different objectives, so that ultimately we are saying this is actually what it costs you to get somebody here or here. If you're, you know, doing a launch event or an event in Asia or an event in the US, we've got that data to back up rather than it being, I guess, anecdotal or looking back up. So, yeah, I guess 6-7 years of just thousands and thousands of campaigns.
So is that data benchmarking survey that you did, I mean, that's a pretty large research project. Is that stuff that you share with your customers, I assume, so that yeah. they don't have to do all of that work?
Exactly, because you would just never guess. I just don't think that would exist anywhere. I don't know anyone that would have done that volume of event campaigns. So at the moment, it's private to us, and we share it with clients, you know, when they're saying, you know, how much is it going to cost me to do things? But ultimately, we do want to make it something that's available so that, you know, people can answer what's good. I think that's the hardest thing, because you've got no context. You don't know what anyone else is doing, whereas what we've now got is a completely anonymized system to say what is good or, you know, what should you be aiming for in your space or your region.
Is PPC something that only like the larger brands with huge events do, or is there value for, you know, an annual conference who's trying to attract 500 to 1,000 attendees or possibly even smaller? I think it's something that's perceived as, you know, the big companies spend their money doing these kinds of advertising. Is that true, or are smaller events doing it?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's definitely not restricted to big advertisers. So we do lots of campaigns. I'd say your smallest budget is around a $2,000 campaign. And what tends to happen is, if you're running a small campaign, it might be that actually no one's ever thought about allocating a budget for PPC because it's just not been in the kind of awareness. But usually once they do, it's a very good return on investment tool because it's so tangible. It's quite hard to get from your other marketing. Okay, how much did that cost us to get that one person there? It's really hard to answer that question. So it's quite common, I'd say, for year one, we start with a small budget and it'll increase, but it will only increase to... ever, we would say PPC should deliver about 30% of your overall results. So some people get really excited when the campaign's going well and they're like, could we spend 100,000? Could we spend 500,000? You just like, there will be a cap on it no matter how big the event could hold to still get attendees at a good cost per acquisition. So yeah, I'd say 2,000 is your minimum. I don't know, the smallest event. No, I mean, we do lots of 100 person conferences, you know. I'd say they're more niche, which is good for PPC. There's a lot less wastage, but yeah, lots of medical, pharmaceutical, industrial, investment, finance, small conferences. As long as it's being marketed, you know. So if you've got an internal event, you know, you're not going to market it. But as long as you're marketing it, yeah, I wouldn't say. And I think the nice thing is you can test it and see if it works. So you don't think, oh, I've just put all of my marketing budget into this thing that I've no idea. As long as you've got time on your side. So a typical conference campaign, maybe 18 weeks, something like that. An expo campaign, 14 weeks. As long as you've got time on your side to see that it's working, and then you can put more money in if you're happy with the results. So it's low risk and it's easy to see if it's working.
Okay. Now, I definitely don't consider myself an expert digital marketer. I'm learning all the time, but I know PPC as pay-per-click, and then I'm pretty sure you can also pay per impressions, like per 1,000 impressions or something, PPI. Am I just making it?
CPM. CPM basis.
So why PPC? Compared to a lot of eyeballs.
So CPM, you're charged on an impression basis. So you're charged for every 1,000 impressions. And I would say that's typically where your big advertisers would work. So it would be like, say you're a charity or an airline, maybe more consumer brand, and you just want to get as many people as possible seeing your ad. Whereas for us, our organizers want to get as many people as possible on their website. So if you're paying on a CPM basis, on a cost per view, basically, they may or may not have gone to the website. If you pay on a cost per click basis, they definitely went to the website. So to us, it's a clearer thing. So say it costs us $1 for every click and we've got a 10% conversion rate, we know that it's going to cost us $10 to get one person to register.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I've heard that most people would say, like McDonald's, for example, why would you still run ads? The idea is because they just need to be in people's faces all the time. Yeah. It's not like you've never heard of McDonald's before.
Exactly. It just makes you think, I do have to say McDonald's.
Yeah. Okay, that's interesting.
Yeah. Awareness is good, and we definitely always want to spend on awareness, but typically we're not running with a McDonald's kind of budget, so we look for a cost per click.
I'm glad we're not, because I'm definitely not working for I have a question that came in from Carolyn Clark, so I want to show you that. How would we know one of your campaigns resulting in a conversion? So how do you know if it's actually going to your website and then turning into a registration, for example?
That's a great question. So we use a piece of code called Google Tag Manager. It's a free piece of code that Google offer, and it allows us to put the code on your website and your registration pages or your forms or whatever you're using. Mm-hmm. And what that allows us to do is, okay, say they get to the / thanks for registering. We say, okay, great, one completed conversion. And we can only capture a conversion if somebody has clicked an ad that we're serving, gone all the way through, converted, and seen that thank you page. So, and same, you know, if it's a form, a data download, whatever it is, there has to be a definitive thing that happens, because I've seen campaigns, you know, that we've taken over and it's like visited contact page, but you know, you don't have any data, nothing's been captured, they might have left. So it's got to be something true that we class as a conversion, like a data capture, basically.
Okay. And I already mentioned that data is a scary word for event planners. I think code, you mentioned code just now. Code, yeah. Your website sounds very scary. I'm assuming, though, you guys help people with that process.
Yeah, for sure. We try and make it as low touch as possible. So we basically need three things. We need images, we need access to existing accounts, and we need this one piece of code to go on the website. Once that one piece of code is on, we set everything else up for you. So, you know, historically, there used to be about 10 pieces of code that you needed, but there just needs to be this one now, and it takes a web developer or your registration partner a couple of minutes to do it.
And that can track, like you said, search and social and all the different.
Yeah. So not getting into all the techie details, but you put all of your tags within the Google Tag Manager container. So if we used Facebook, Bing, LinkedIn, whatever, we put them all in there, and we could track multiple objectives. So we might track visitors, exhibitors, conference, you know, whatever other objectives we're tracking. So we might end up with, like, I don't know, 20 tags and triggers, but we do all of that for you. We just tell you it's working.
Okay. So one of my questions is, in terms of your background and your husband's background, what about your personalities or your experience gets you interested in this stuff? I know for a lot of people, it's just overwhelming and they don't want to even know. What makes you excited about learning about PPC and
results? It's such a fast moving industry. You know, there is so much, like the Google Marketing Conference was just in May, I think, this year. And all the stuff that came out was like brand new for us, brand new for our clients. And it's just still really fresh. So even though we always do the same kind of objective, I think there's just so much new stuff coming out that it's really good to do. And I think it's good when you get good at something, which I now feel like we get it. And when we get good results, it's good, and happy clients. Yeah, I think that's what everyone wants is good feedback ultimately. So that keeps us going. And yeah, there's complicated problems that we have to solve. But yeah, I think we have an amazing team that helps us do that. So yeah, we're really lucky to be in this space.
So speaking of complicating things that you have to solve, Carolyn also has another question, and this is a really good question, I think. When you look at the average event organization, they have data in about 1,000 different places. It is often very dirty. It comes from multiple sources. How does that work? Can you help people kind of take, so for example, I know people who have 100,000 people on various lists, but do they have a single list that has them with all the correct information and it's perfectly organized and it's segmented? No.
No.
How does that help or hinder your process? And how
ultimately, I think if they've got the data organized, great. But as you say, a lot of people don't. We do different things. So part of our campaign is building new data, so we don't need any lists from the client. Part of it is using retargeting. So we look at cookies on the website. So if someone's visited the Y exhibit page and they didn't convert, let's retarget them. If they visited interior design workshops and they didn't convert, let's show them an ad for interior design workshops. So that kind of takes away your reliance so heavily on data. If they do have data, we can also use that. So say, for instance, they've got 100,000 people and they're like, I don't know if this is any good, but we have it. We take that data and we upload it to Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, and we match that data. So Google or Facebook is saying to us, okay, we've got a 50% match rate. So very quickly, you've kind of removed the half of the database that you were never going to reach anyway. It cross-references it with Google or Facebook or LinkedIn, and then we only show ads to those people when they're active on the platform. So really what you're doing with any data that we get is showing it to the most relevant people at the time they're actually on the platform. So it really cuts out all of that, you know, email marketing to half a dead database, basically. So it gives you all of that flexibility. So I think that's a really good thing to do. And the other thing with the data that we like to do is say we take your past attendees, for example, we can then create a lookalike audience on those past attendees to say, okay, go find me more people like these people because they, you know, they're the right kind of audience for us. So yeah, I think if they can give us the data, you know, in whatever state they want, it doesn't really matter because we're going to cross match it anyway.
Okay, that makes sense. Now, this is not just in the events industry, but I have experienced myself, I know family and friends, you've kind of referenced this already. Let's say you're looking up something that you want to buy on your computer and then suddenly your Facebook feed is filled with all these ads for that particular thing that you were looking for. Or, and I've seen it on the phone. I know that I even believe that it works when your phone is not even, when you're not actively searching, but it's in the room and you're talking about something. I have seen some crazy things come up. And I think that like line is very blurry and sometimes makes people feel very uncomfortable that when they go visit your website, they suddenly see an ad. But obviously there's a ton of power in that, especially for marketers. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, the stuff that's creepy as a user that everyone experiences is generally great for advertisers. I think lookalike audiences are extremely powerful now. So, you know, there's all this data and you can say, find me people who look like this, and that's how you end up seeing those ads. Retargeting. I think with retargeting, organizers have to make sure that they've updated their privacy policy to say that that's what they're going to be doing, that they're capturing cookies and they will be showing you ads. You can always opt out of those ads, and that's what I say to organizers as well. If somebody sees an ad and they don't like it or they don't think it's relevant, they can click, why am I seeing this ad? And then that's quite good to know, because then you say, oh, I'm in this list that I don't really want to be in, or I'm in this audience, I don't think I should be in that. So you can then opt out of that, or you can complain. So the user does have freedom to do that. But yeah, I think it can be overwhelming as a user. But yeah, as an advertiser, we use a lot of retargeting and we use lookalike audiences, and they tend to get very, very good results.
I mean, it makes a lot of sense that if you have a list of past attendees and you want to amplify that, it makes sense to target that audience. So I think it's a good reminder for the general public that we do have control over what we see and what we receive. And, you know, it's one thing to sit back and complain that we don't like to see it, but we do have the ability to turn it off.
Yeah, you can. And lots of people never think about doing that, but definitely I do it all the time. If there's stuff I don't like, you know, I turn it off because I think I shouldn't be seeing that. And it's a waste of money for the advertisers as well. But ultimately, you just are really refining the algorithms as well for Facebook and Instagram, because you're saying, I don't like this ad, I like this ad, I'm engaging here. So the machines are just getting smarter and smarter. So as time goes on, if you think about the ads you saw maybe 3 or 4 years ago were probably a lot less relevant than the ones you see now. It's like the thing you were just talking about, or the thing that you feel like you just told somebody a couple of days ago, and then you see the ads. And yeah, you know, voice search is the next thing that's coming. So yeah, I think everybody's a little suspicious of the ads that they see based on things they've been talking about, not necessarily searching on their phone.
So you just kind of led into my next question, which is, what do you think is next in the search space and in targeting and retargeting? You mentioned voice search.
Yeah, we were expecting to get some sort of big announcement from Google this year, but it's not come. But that will be the next thing on how that's capitalized on. Mobile continues to dominate. And I think what we're seeing is lots of mobile-specific creative, mobile-specific videos and things like that. Instagram stories is the fastest growing format ever. It's just absolutely huge. So the things that we're focused on this year for our clients are mobile first ad creative and video. Video is really underpriced media at the moment. So it's much cheaper to advertise on YouTube or Facebook video as opposed to search, which is getting more expensive every year. So I would say that's a tip for any organizers to get video content wherever possible of exhibitors or attendees, because you can really use that and it won't cost you as much as search.
This is a big topic we're talking about, not only PPC, but just data in general and how we can use it. It's such a powerful tool. It can, you know, really increase the number of sponsors, exhibitors, attendees that we have at our events, but it's just a big thing. Do you have any recommendations in terms of, let's say a planner is really interested in using this for their events, or their client is, where do they stay up to date on all of these changes? And like, where do you get your information from?
I like the AdWords blog. I think like goes straight to the horse's mouth. Google Insights is really good as well. That's like got a lot of great case studies on there. I think about stuff that is maybe that you wouldn't know about, or just kind of nicely packaged. Google Trends is good just to see what's the latest there. And then specifically on PPC, PPC Hero, WordStream are the blogs that we would use. And then there's loads of great resources, like Google Digital Garage is free. If you're more interested in learning some of the stuff yourself, you can do the Google Ads Academy. And so there's lots of great content, just take lots of great videos as well. I would try and consume by video, because I think it's easier to get, and when you see all the screen shares and things like that. But yeah, those are probably my key resources.
There's a lot to learn. I have a lot to learn.
I have a lot to learn. So.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. If people want to reach out to you and learn more about your career, or they want to learn more about Tag Digital, where should they go?
You can get me on LinkedIn, just Laura Davidson, or just email me, laura@tagdigital.co.uk. And then, yeah, we can try and help you with anything that you have. And just reach out and ask questions. Like, you know, we're really happy just to talk about PPC and events. There's no pressure.
So I'm really glad you said that, because we still have actually questions in the conversation that we did not get a chance to get to. So if you wouldn't mind, I'm going to put your contact information in the thread on Facebook. I'll also, we're going to post this, of course, on our blog, and so people will see that. But if you wouldn't mind, after being able to answer any of the outstanding questions, because there are a few from Adam and Carolyn that we did not get to today, I would encourage our listeners to keep the conversation going. If you are watching the show after it has gone live, you can still ask questions and Laura will get notified. I will try to keep up with them as well, because like we said, this is a really huge topic and I think there's a lot that that is coming in this space. So Laura, thank you so much for taking the time to join us. I know here in the US we have a holiday week coming up, so it's kind of a crazy week for people. But it was great to see those of you who are watching and asking questions. Thank you so much for doing that. I hope you guys all have a great week. We will not have an episode next week because I'm teaching a course at NYU that's 9 to 5 every day. So it'll be a pretty long course, but we'll be back the following week with another great guest at 10:30 on Tuesdays as our usual time. Laura, thank you so much again for taking the time to tell us about this topic and talk about your business. And I look forward to staying in touch with you.
Great. Thanks. Well, have a great holiday week, everybody.
Yes. Have a great week, everyone. And we'll see you soon.
Thanks.
Hustle hard.
Bye.